There is morning for you. Good morning. It's a different time here, but it doesn't matter. Good to be able to see your faces again. And we welcome everyone that is joined to this meeting in the name of the Lord. And definitely we're living in a difficult times. And we, as a people of God, we need to understand the privilege the Lord position the Lord has placed us upon, and to understand that the Lord has given us something very precious, and in His love that we are in, He has called us unto, nothing can overshadow us. And just want to have a starting point in the Gospel of John chapter 16, and just one verse. I'm going to look to today as a theme, because a lot of people like to follow a theme, and it's a good thing to follow a theme, but you see which way we're gonna the Lord is gonna lead us to today. The theme is gonna be in Christ. So we need to understand now that the Lord has called us, and we are in Christ, we are in Him, and what that means. Okay, let's go to the Gospel of John, chapter 16, just one verse. We're gonna read verse 33. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you should have tribulations, but be of a good cheer. I have overcome the world. So in other words, the Lord is telling us before He's gonna go away, and that these things will come in our lives. We are not excluded, we're still in this world, okay? The things will come against us, the tribulations, circumstances, difficulties, but the Lord is telling us to be of a good cheer, because you are, that you in me might have peace, in Him. In other words, what really tells us, we have the Spirit, He dwells us, but it's up to us now to want, to desire, to be in Him. Just so another verse, back a couple of pages, chapter 14, just one verse. Maybe two, three verses there. The Gospel of John, again, chapter 14. Let me just establish this. It says, verse 18, 19, and 20, just three verses. It's most verses connected to this, but just straight to the point. It says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world sees me no more, but you see me, because I live, you shall live also. It's referring to the Holy Spirit He's going to send. And the Holy Spirit is Jesus Himself. Because Jesus was here, the world didn't understand Him, didn't recognize Him. We're going to see other scriptures along this line. But verse 20, at the day, you shall know. When we see the comfort of the Holy Spirit, He says, at the day, you shall know that I am in my Father, you in me, and I in you. It's an incredible, our minds, brothers and sisters, cannot comprehend the oneness that the Lord God the Almighty has made us to be in Him through the sacrifice of His Son. In Colossians chapter 3, just one more verse, this is to highlight this a bit more. Colossians chapter 3, a lot of verses there, but I'm just going to pick one verse. All right, Colossians chapter 3, verse 3. Yes, I read from that. This is one verse. And it says here, for you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. It's incredible. in the place the Lord has placed us in. Alive, we are dead, the old person is dead, is finished, that person, and went through the waters of baptism, but alive is hidden with Christ in God. It's the oneness, the bond that applies us upon the safety. So if we understand the privileged position the Lord has placed us upon, no matter what happened around us, what we might see with our natural eyes, then nothing can cause us to be discouraged or to be confused or to let go or to be fearful, because God has placed us in His bosom, in His oneness, to be with Him through Christ Jesus our Lord. So I'm just going to go to see why we're just a human, natural man, that it was nothing good about us. The Lord has caused that to bring us into such a special place, privileged place in Him. Of course, we can go from the very beginning. I just want to say a couple of things only. I'm not going to touch the very beginning. But before God created man and everything around the earth and the animals, He prepared a sacrifice. That's why we read in the scriptures there's a preordained sacrifice before the foundation of the world. That's His plan and His love for all humanity, for all creation. But we need to understand that out of all the billions in this world that exist before us and now, you and I, somehow the Lord sort of fear to call us, to open our eyes to see, and our ears to hear His calling. But how can you and I be the temple of the living God? How you and I can reflect the glory of God in our lives? Just going to see some scriptures in the book of Psalms 85. Can you please stand there with me? But I'm going to follow the theme in Him as we're going to go through. Because without Him, we're going to sit without the scriptures, we are nothing. It's not only to receive the Spirit, but to continue to be in Him. The book of Psalms 195. Not so 195, 85, sorry. 85. I read from verse 10. Three verses we're going to read here. Four verses. It says, mercy and truth are met together. Now I want you to fill you in what he's referring to here. It's a prophecy foretelling us Christ is going to come. And it's telling us mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. Truth shall spring out of the earth, and righteousness shall look down from heaven. I just want to pause there. It's referring to Jesus who's going to come to become a natural man, to take the form of a man. And the final thing he was going to do, he was going to die for us. And he's going to come out. He's going to come out from the grave to accomplish this. When it says, truth out from the earth, and righteousness look down from heaven. Yea, the law shall give that which is good, and our land shall yield her increase. I'm going to expound a little bit this more of this here. If we understand that it's referring to Christ, it says, yea, the law shall give that which is good. It's referring to Christ. When I read it in the Greek language, it says Christotis, which is Christ. Because you cannot find the word good to understand it. Good means, today it doesn't mean anything, really. They don't even comprehend, or it's so watered down. But it's referring to Christ, his goodness. The only good, you remember, is no one good, only God is good. And it says, I read it again in this context again. Yea, the law shall give that which is good, which is Christness, and a land shall yield her increase. A land is referring to the ground, the earth. And when it says the increase, in the Greek language, says the fruit. So when we receive Christ, his goodness in us, we're going to bear the fruit. Otherwise, we cannot bear any fruit or any goodness in our own selves. The Lord has come and dwelt inside us. The ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ began when we received the Spirit. It's a perfect example. And it says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He anointed me to preach the gospel, and so on. So the ministry with the apostles began in the day of Pentecost. So our ministry, also our lives, that he can give us, he begins only when we receive the Spirit. His goodness, his love comes and dwells inside us. And then he says, righteousness should go before him. He's referring to Christ, and shall set us in the way of his steps. So the Lord is telling us clearly that to be in him, when we are in him, he will guide our steps. He will guide us into his life, into his righteousness. We're going to bear the fruit. We read in the Gospel of John, I am the true vine. You are the branches. If you abide in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. This is with another verse further down. Without me, you can do nothing. Let's go to Isaiah 32 along these lines again. Because you need to lock it in to understand what God has prepared for us, what he called us to be, how he turned our wilderness, the dry ground, there was no goodness in us, to something beautiful in his sight, brothers and sisters. And we have to honor. The Bible tells us he has given us his name. He made us his own, brothers and sisters. This is his talk, not of condemnation. This is a talk of encouragement to recognize our calling. And we read in one of the commandments, do not take the name of the Lord in vain. Is that a value? We must recognize this and lock it in, brothers and sisters. Chapter 32, the book of Isaiah. But you see, all these things is referring to for telling us Christ is going to come. I read a couple of verses, verse 1 and 2, and then read from verse 15 after that. Verse 1, Isaiah 32. Behold, a king shall reign in righteousness, and princes shall rule in judgment. Princes is referring to us. He calls us to be a holy nation, a special people, a royal priesthood, written in Peter. And a man should be as a hidden place from the wind and cover from the tempest of rivers of water, in a dry place, as in the shadow of a great rock in a weary land. Definitely the world is a weary land. It is in trouble, in serious trouble. This is what the rock is referring to, is Christ. This is what the Lord has blessed us, brothers and sisters. Then verse 15, it says, until the Spirit be poured upon us from on high, and the wilderness, talks referred to our lives, be fruit fulfilled. And the fruit fulfilled be counted for a forest. Then judgment should dwell in the wilderness, and righteousness remain in a fruitful field. Remember, we need to remember continuously this. Without him, you cannot bear any fruit, you can do nothing. But when we are in him, the Father is the husbandman. He will prune us to bear more fruit, says the Lord to us. And the works, this is the effect of when we are, this is our life. And the works of righteousness, it's not words, it's the works of righteousness. So be peace. And the effect of righteousness, whiteness, and assurance forever. And my people should dwell in peaceable habitation, in a sure dwelling, and quiet resting places, no matter what happens into the world, brothers and sisters. When our life is hidden with God in Christ Jesus, when our thoughts and the things that we do dwell upon on the things above, and we allow him and his word to be in our hearts, in our minds, in action. Not words, just only know them. In action, the effects of righteousness. When we live in the Spirit, when we walk in the Spirit, this is the outcome, brothers and sisters. We dwell in a safe place, a place that cannot be moved. So no matter what's happening, brothers and sisters around us, nothing can move us. Let's go to Colossians. I had another chapter there in the book of Luke. It says, the dive spring, oh, let's go there. I want to read it, just read it. Now we go to the New Testament. We see how it follows what we read, but it's referring to Christ and us. The Gospel of Luke. Just a couple of verses. We read verse 78 and 79. Through the tender mercies of our God, whereby the tide spring from on high have visited us. The diet is referring to Christ. The diet of the Lord came. He was born of a woman. He was foretelling us he now is going to be born of a woman.
Pastor Emmanouil, what
to chapter? Give light to them that sit in darkness and in the shadow of death. This is the outcome when man lives in darkness, away from God, no goodness in him, desolate, cannot breathe anything good. The end of that man is death. And the Lord Jesus Christ, brothers and sisters, broke the chains that were bound down to him. And he sent us free. And he says here to guide our feet into the way of peace. Must walk alone and follow him. And we're going to see what that means, follow him, as we look into this thing this morning, brothers and sisters. Colossians chapter 2. The book of Colossians, chapter 2. We're a bit slow here than the pages. We read verse 9. A lot of appropriate scriptures there, but I'm just going to put. For in him, in Christ, dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. This is what all is. In him, all the fullness of God dwell in him bodily. Hebrews chapter 1, one more verse there. A lot of proper scriptures there, but I'm not going to let you tell to all of them, but just one. Verse 3. Who being the brightness, is referring to Christ again, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. Now, Jesus is in all the fullness of God dwell bodily, and he is the express image of his person. In other words, when you walk in this earth, he expressed, he demonstrated, he revealed, he manifests God the Father, his holiness, his purity. And it says, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he by himself purged our sins and sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. You know what it does? Sit on the right hand of the majesty on high. He prepared a place for us, immediate for us. Not only is God, he's everything, he's the creator of all things, upholding all things in the power of his hand, but he took a natural body like you and I, so he can understand our fears, our weakness, everything that we might face in this world, to be the perfect mediator between you and I, personally, do not. Thank you. These phones don't need to be thrown in the water. So then let's go to the Gospel of John, chapter 1. Brothers and sisters, let's go there. Gospel of John, chapter 1. So we highlighted the perfect example, who he is, what he represents, what he reflects, what he came to do, and so on. But now, let's look at it. What it means to be in him. Chapter 1, the Gospel of John. lot of scriptures there, very appropriate, written in the context. Of course, the very first verses, he says, the life of Jesus is the light of man. So the life of Jesus in us, when we live in him, he makes us to be the light of man, the light of the world. Brothers and sisters, I don't need to understand it. This is what he made us to be. Verse 14, the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 14. And the Word was made flesh. Jesus is the Word of God, but he took the form of a man, the Word himself. He became flesh and dwell among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. We read in Psalm 35, righteousness and truth met together and so on. And says, within the Father, is within Christ, you know, here. John bear witness of him, Christ, saying, this was he of whom I speak, he that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he is before me. But John the Baptist was born 6 months before Christ, but he understands he's referring to Christ, his pre-existence. And then verse 16, listen to this, brothers and sisters, lock it in. And of his fullness, whatever Christ is, what he represents, what he reflects, of his fullness have we all received. And grace for grace. All the fullness, all the authority, all the power that God is to have received. That's why you see our lives is hidden with God in Christ. For it says, for the Lord was given by Moses, by grace and truth, came by Jesus. Yeah. I like to go to 1 Peter, chapter 2. Some Greek words here, but I'll explain it to see from what the scripture is going to tell us here now. How do we follow his footsteps? How do he guide us lives into his footsteps? I believe, of course, we all know that it's his perfect example. Okay, but I'm going to see that what we live in is true. First Peter, chapter 2. I'm going to read from verse 21. Says here, for even hereunto we you are called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example to follow his steps. To follow in a Greek language, it means ichni. I'll explain what it means. Here says his steps. You probably might have seen some chart, you know, some maps, the footprints of Christ, why he went, which way he went, and so on. But to me, the ichni, this word, means not only to follow where he went, exactly where he went, who he met, what he said, who he was talking to. So I try to put in into the life of Jesus who written in the fourth gospel. We can see the pre-existence and right through the scriptures for telling us who he was, where he's going to come. But now we look in the life of Jesus. And I try to close my eyes in my prayers. And I start from the first gospel, how Jesus was born. In my mind, it went to certain points, and I wanted to follow his life with my mind, to memorize it, the effect that he might have on me, if I remember his life, how he dealt, how to who he talked, how he talked, how he answered, how he handled matters. And I went to certain points, and then I had to jump to another gospel, to another gospel. What I'm leading to is this. I'm 70 plus now, and certain things in my life that had such an effect in me, even when I was 3 years old. I'll give you an example so you understand what I'm leading to. When my mother gave birth to my brother, I was only 3 years old. I still remember, 3 years old, I still remember what game I was playing. When they called me, that my mother had a baby, a brother for me. It so much infected me, I remember everything about that time. Never left me. Certain other things that had so impressed in me, you probably experienced the same. You can, it's like it happened just now, just a few minutes ago, a second ago. But other things, so many other things in my life, I don't remember anything. I try to go back in my memories, I don't remember anything. So how much effect have the life that Jesus lived in us? Because our mind and our heart, which is connected, is very powerful through the Holy Spirit. But the words of Jesus, the life of Jesus, the characteristics of Jesus, that's what you mean, the character, his behavior, everything. If we all of us search it out like this, it's kind of grafted in our hearts, in our minds, that would be very real. And our behavior will change. Our character will change. Because the word of God will refines us. It settles us. It chastises us. It corrects us. His life must have all the influence in us, brothers and sisters. I read another verses here. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Actually, Ephesians chapter 5. The book of Ephesians, chapter 5. It says here, verse 1 and 2. Be ye therefore followers of God, as a dear children. I want to correct this word, followers. Because in a Greek word, it says, instead of followers, it says, mimites. Reflect, be like him. Imitate him. Followers of God means you are a follower of Jesus. It's just a word. But if you put the right word in there, it's to be like him. As a dear children, not just children, we are precious children to God. We We are precious in his sight, brothers and sisters. And he gets, and then he says, and walk in love, as Christ also he loved us. And he had given us, he had given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. When he's talking to us, it's one perfect sacrifice, and he's referring to Christ here, and it was a sweet smelling savor. But I want to read in the book of Romans, chapter 12, he says, well, to present our lives a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto the Lord, which is your reasonable service. Now, this is word very powerful, and why the Lord is leading us to die. But it's only can happen when we are in him. We immerse our lives, our thoughts, our heart, our doings, our actions, in everything that we do every day in him. His glory is going to be manifest in us, brothers and sisters. Let's look at another scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, please. A couple of verses there. I'll read from verse 14 to 15. Here Paul is expressing, he says, for the love of Christ constrained us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we are all dead. This word constrained us. In English, it says similar, but in what I'm going to express to you in Greek, it says to bind together or tight. In the Greek language, it says sphingi. Can only if you see my hands, if you put your hands together like this and squeeze it close together. That's how the love of God that he expressed towards us holds us tied together, and to understand it. So this same love, he expects us to reflect and demonstrate to others, brothers and sisters. For that he died for all, verse 15, that they which should live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which he died for them, he rose again. If we live for him, if we died in our own life, and no ugly characteristics we had in our lives, attributes that were no good, full of darkness, but all at the goodness of the Lord, and we surrender our lives to him, and beside the love that he loved us, we love one another, then for us, for them, he rose again. Otherwise, we miss out. The Bible tells us, brothers, sisters, not to take our salvations of the Lord, he brought us out too lightly. To behold the goodness and the severity of the Lord. Severity for those that don't, but for goodness for those that continue in his goodness. Because remember, none of us is good. No, not one. When we are in him only, we can reflect his goodness. And the example I gave reading the stories of the gospel, brothers and sisters. And let our hearts follow his footsteps, his ichni, his characteristics. Remember every step of the way. If you desire, it becomes a desire. The Lord, he says, you grafted it into our hearts, into our mind. And that's what is going to keep us. And that's what is going to strengthen us, continue in this life that we live in. And the glory of God will be manifest in us. The Bible tells us, let's go to Hebrews chapter 10, 31 scriptures. Maybe I'll finish there. I've got so many other scriptures, but I'm not going to drag it along. But we just got to remember the steps of the good men are ordered by the Lord. And he delighted in his ways. Must delighted in the ways of the Lord. And the example in his life, like he said, before us to follow. Verse chapter 10 of Hebrews. Verse 22. Let us draw near with a true heart and a full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. What is the profession of our faith? Who do we profess? Who do we demonstrate? Who do we reflect? What do we recommend? Hopefully we all of us to recommend Christ. For he is faithful, the promise. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works. Let us provoke one another, brothers and sisters, as the Lord and the love of God constrain us, calls us tied together, and it provoked us to love him. His love. We love him because he first loved us. And he gave us an example to follow his footsteps. And verse 25, brothers and sisters, says, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, so much the more as you see the day approaching. And all the people said, the day is approaching, fix our hearts and eyes upon him. Rejoice in our salvation. Let other people know, encourage one another, let other people know. All the people said again. Okay, back to you, Pastor Southie.